Assalamu alaikum. Thank you all. I hope you enjoyed your break. We're going to start our next session. Our first speaker, Dr. Fida Alaaddin. Dr. Fida is an interventional radiologist. He is head of the outreach program in the hospital. I want to thank him very much.
Not for outreach program.
Mutation prevention program. So he's going to talk about imaging of non-vascular, non-invasive imaging of critical
incident. Assalamu alaikum again. Of course, it's very difficult for interventional radiologist or radiologist to speak to vascular surgeon. That's from the start. I was telling Dr. Rana, I think this is a very unique workshop. Maybe it can be in Guinness book that interventional radiologist organizing workshop for vascular surgeons. So please forgive me for any mistakes.
You are leading the
whole world. Thank you very much. Thanks. No, I mean, without you, we will not be here. As Dr. Muhammad said, I mean, with your cooperation, we managed to do what we are doing. Now, again, as a radiologist, I remember when I started my residency and then my first years as a consultant in UK, we used to be proud to talk about the latest and updates in CT scan and MRA and CT MRA and CT angiogram and so on. And in the three centers I worked in UK, one center, Doppler was number one. They didn't use any MRA or CTA, but it is proper Doppler. That every patient should have proper Doppler from the aorta down to the ankles. In another one, MRA was the tool of examination. The third one was the CT angiogram. And to be honest, I am totally honest with you, the issue of ankle brachial index for me was not something that I was really interested in. Till I came to this hospital, and again, I had a discussion with this great man, Dr. Chambari. It took me maybe 1.5 years to realize that this issue of ankle brachial index is something serious. And I don't need to be very gloating about the advancement of MRA and CT angiogram to diagnose critical limb ischemia. And the more I read about this, and the more I followed what happened around the world, I found that there's really big shift from the big advancement in technology in MR and CT towards the basics, which was known before, ankle brachial index and whatever came after that. So if you are thinking that this lecture will be mainly about CT and MRA, unfortunately you will be disappointed. It will be mainly about what you know, ankle brachial index and its brothers and sisters, and how we now diagnose chronic limb ischemia. Dr. Faris, in his lecture, in a way covered a lot of what I would have to say, but I will try to expand on some of the issues and see where are the shortcomings in some of the examinations and how we can deal with them. So basically, the diagnostic tools to evaluate chronic limb ischemia can be categorized into two categories. One, physiologic tools, and the other one, direct imaging tools. The physiologic tools include ankle brachial index, toe brachial index, segmental pressure, pulse volume recording, and transcutaneous oxygen saturation. The direct imaging, as you know, include ultrasound, CT angiogram, MRA, and conventional angiogram. The most common used non-invasive, non-imaging testing are, as you know, ABI, segmental pressure, and BVR. The indications for that, of course, include claudication, wrist pain, gangrene, assessment of feeling potential, and absent of peripheral pulses. The primary examination, again, as I started my talk with, is the ankle brachial index, which you all are aware of. It is reported that it is as sensitive as 95%, as specific as specific up to 99%. However, there is a caveat here that after you exclude heavily calcified vessels, and in diabetes, as you know, many patients have this problem. So, in patients who have reasonable exam. This is specific and sensitive and is a very good screening test. And all patients who have ABI less than 0.9 are diagnosed with peripheral artery disease. This is a well-known fact. The advantage of ankle brachial index that it can stratify the severity of the disease between mild, moderate, and severe, as we can see and we know, and also it can assist the progression and response to treatment by follow-up. It also can predict cardiovascular and cerebrovascular mortality. As you all know, the way we do it, we measure the highest systolic pressure among the anterior tibial and posterior tibial artery at specific ankle, and we divide that over the highest brachial systolic pressure in both sides. Normal values between 0.9 to 1.3, severe disease if it is less than 0.4, and mild and moderate, as you can see, between 0.7 to 0.9 and 0.4 to 0.7. However, the major problem if the vessels, as I said earlier, is calcified. In that case, in many cases, you will find that the result is more than 1.3, and in that case, the exam is not reliable at all, and we have then to look at other means of evaluation. There is a problem also that I will discuss later as well, that in some patients, in ideal world, the ABI should be less than 0.9. Let us say should be 0.7. However, because the vessel is heavily calcified, the degree of the pressure we need to apply to compress the artery would be higher. So the result of that, there will be false negative result because the ABI will be like 0.9 to 1. However, this patient had disease, but because of calcification, we are getting false negative result. So ABI per se is a great screening test, but we need to be open-minded about the issue of calcification, which we can tackle by other means. Just to stress that we start this examination, we have to put the patient rest for 5 minutes and alleviate all any anxiety to get a proper test, and to use handheld Doppler 5 to 10 megahertz. This is just an example. All of you know how we measure ABI, but just refreshing memory. You see here in the left brachial artery, the systolic pressure is 160. This is higher than the other side, so we consider this as the brachial artery to consider in the ABI result. In the right side, the highest pressure is in the dorsalis pedis, this is 160, so the ABI here is 1, it's normal. However, on the other side, the highest systolic pressure is in the posterior tibial artery, it's 100, and the ABI accordingly is 0.63, which is indicating moderate disease. And by the way, the lowest ABI is the one can help us to predict the outcome of these patients. Again, as I mentioned earlier, the most important limitation is calcification, which is a lot in our patients, especially in Saudi Arabia with diabetic patients. Also, if the brachial artery, or there's difference in systolic pressure between the two arms in brachial artery pressure, more than 20 millimeter mercury, in that case, the exam is also could be unreliable, as that indicates vascular disease in the upper limbs. It's important to highlight here a fact that we all know that ABI per se will tell us there is a disease, but it doesn't tell us where is the disease. It's anywhere between the aorta and the ankle. Let us say we have a patient with normal ABI. It is mandatory to have the patient exercising, ideally on treadmill, and then to repeat the ABI after 1 minute, and if it is less than 0.9, then the patient really have a disease. So the exercise is important part of the examination to say there is a disease or not. Now, one tool to overcome the issue of calcification, as Dr. Fares mentioned in his talk, is toe brachial index. The other advantage of the toe brachial index that it tells us about perfusion of the foot. The ABI tells you till the level of the ankle, doesn't tell you about the foot. So this is also an important way to assess the foot itself, in which we have a problem with in many patients. So the value here is different from the ABI. It is normal if it is more than 0.7, and abnormal if it is less than that. Now, if we have a patient who has abnormal ABI or toe brachial index, then we can move a step forward to know where is the level of the occlusion or stenosis by using segmental pressure. The way we do it, we have cuff at the top of the thigh, at the lower aspect of the thigh, then another one at the top of the leg, and a fourth one at the lower aspect of the leg. Now, generally, if there is drop of more than 30 millimeter mercury between any two cuffs, then there is disease between these two cuffs. In the case of the ratio between the brachial artery and proximal thigh, if the ratio is less than 0.9, that tells us there is aortoiliac disease. So, without any direct imaging, we can at least know where is the disease using segmental pressure. This is a very good example of what I am talking about. Here, a patient who has an ABI on the right side, which is 0.59, and on the left side, it's 0.52. So he has moderate disease according to the ABI stratification. If we look more carefully at the segmental pressure, you will find that there is a drop more than 30 millimeter mercury in both sides, worse on the right side. Here the ratio is 0.71, and the ratio here is 0.8 at the level of the upper thigh. So that per se tells you there is a disease in the iliac arteries, or aortoiliac disease. And this is really confirmed by the CT angiogram. Here you see the stenosis in the left external iliac artery, and this shows you a disease in the right external iliac artery. So this confirmed just by segmental pressure. If we look more carefully, you will find that there is also drop in pressure between proximal thigh and proximal leg. Note here the pressure is 111 and here is 84. Again, it's more than 30 millimeter mercury, and that per se tells you there is also a disease in the superficial femoral artery. The same is happening on the right side. When you look at the angiogram, you can see here that there is occlusion of the superficial femoral artery on the right side, confirming what we found in the segmental pressure. And also in the left side, we can see that there is stenosis in distal superficial femoral artery. So even without looking at the CT scan, we are confident that there's aortoiliac disease in this patient, as well as bilateral superficial femoral artery. The contraindication to use segmental pressure is if the patient is having acute DVT. You don't want to make pressure on the vein and then push the thrombus to the pulmonary arteries. Or if patient has intervention recently with stenting or graft, just a precaution, you don't want to squash the graft or the stent. Or if the patient has a cast or wound that preclude having pressure by the cuff. Now, the third way to assess the artery without direct imaging is PVR. The concept in this examination is different from ABI and toe brachial index or segmental pressure. In this exam, it represents the sum of blood flow through the examined area. It doesn't tell us if the artery itself, the main artery, is stenotic or occluded. So if the patient has stenosis or occlusion, but he has very good collaterals compensating the occlusion or stenosis, you will find that the PVR is normal. And this is important for us before treatment, because if the ABI is telling us there is moderate or severe disease because there is stenosis or occlusion, but the PVR is telling us there is no such thing, it's mild or no disease, then you may decide to wait and follow up the patient rather than to rush to intervention based on the ABI. So in this exam, you can see that In this case, we did the toe brachial index on the left side. It is 0.62, which is less than 0.7, the normal value. So it indicates that there is some peripheral artery disease, some sort of stenosis or occlusion, whatever. It's not severe, but it tells you there's something. But when you look at the PVR, it is totally symmetrical to the other side. And the other side, you will find that the ABI is really normal. So it tells us that the collaterals in this patient really has compensated whatever caused by the stenosis or occlusion in the main arteries. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the ankle brachial index, the problem with it is calcification. This is not a problem with the PVR. So in patients who have heavy calcification and has either unreliable exam because the ABI is more than 1.3, or in the other category I mentioned, in which the ABI is becoming falsely negative. I mean, as I mentioned, the ABI should be in the range, let us say, 0.7 to 0.8, but because of calcification, we have to increase the blood, the pressure to compress the artery, so the ABI becomes above 0.9. In that group of patients, also PVR is very important to tell us if there is disease or no disease. In fact, in the group that ends up with unreliable exam because of a value more than 1.3 in one study, there is a proved peripheral artery disease in more than 60% of these patients. So although the ABI is not reliable, but there is disease. The way forward to know if there is disease is really to look at the PVR, because it will tell us if there is enough perfusion in the artery or in the limb or not. That's why PVR is really recommended by the European Society of Cardiology and American Heart Association as a second line of assessment of these patients. This is an exam, I think, done by Mona, our great technologist here. And you see she applied a pressure, very high pressure, more than 290. But despite that, the artery was not compressed because of the heavy calcification. So the exam is not reliable. However, when we looked at the PVR, there are mild changes suggesting mild disease rather than severe disease. And so we are happy with the result. And in fact, we confirmed this by doing Doppler ultrasound. There's full Doppler ultrasound for this patient, but I just choose the anterior tibial and posterior tibial arteries in both sides, and both showed patent vessels with good biphasic Doppler waveforms. So this is an important tool to complement the ABR. Now, PVR itself has its own limitation. As we said, first of all, it doesn't tell us which artery is diseased or if it's occluded or stenosed, and it can give false results with congestive heart failure or movement of, or if there is sympathetic nerve input. How does this work? We put the cuffs, as we did with the segmental pressure. These cuffs have special detectors that can check the difference in volume between systole and diastole. And by doing this, it reflects by putting a waveform reflecting the PVR, and the shape of the PVR tells us if there is normal disease or normal or abnormal result. This is the typical normal waveform created by PVR. This is the normal again. You can see there is sharp upstroke, there is a notch, and there is a period where there is a flat line between the peaks. If we lose the notch and this flat period, then we have mild disease, as in this case. If the upslope equals the downslope, so this equals this, then that's a moderate disease. If it becomes more flattened and the amplitude is really weak, then this is severe disease. And we call this category 1, and that's category 4 accordingly. And this, as I told you, give us how is the perfusion. Again, this is a shape of how the PVR wave moves from normal to severe disease. Other tool, physiologic tool to assess the chronic limb ischemia, we don't use it here, but I saw it in many centers in Europe. Dr. Menzi in Italy, for example, this is crucial in his unit, which is transcutaneous oxygen saturation, in which we measure the oxygen tension 1 to 2 millimeters deep in the skin from the local capillary. If the result is less than 40, that indicates ischemia and is associated with higher amputation. It has its own limitation. It can be affected with high altitude, and also it can be not very reliable in patients with pulmonary and heart disease or in patients who have lower limb edema or skin thickness. Also, it takes a relatively long time. Now, moving on from physiologic tools and assessment, which is your work, should be, and to our radiologist sphere, which is diagnostic direct imaging tools. The most common and most used is ultrasound. There are three ways to assess arteries using a duplex ultrasound. One is by B-mode, which is the black and white image you see, or by color assessment, and also by the shape of the waveform created by the artery. Now, in the B-mode, we look at the lumen, diameter, and wall of the vessel, and also if there are any collaterals, and also to see anything surrounding the vessel. In this example, you can see, I don't know if it's clear or not, but believe me, there is some filling defect in here, and that represents thrombus. This is just from B mode without applying any color Doppler. We can see here that a plaque is causing stenosis in the artery, and in this case, there is occlusion. Forget about the color, but this you can really appreciate it just by looking at it in black and dark image. Now, the other advantage of Doppler ultrasound that it tells us if there is aneurysm. And in fact, this can be very valuable, even an advantage over conventional angiogram. Because let us say there is popliteal artery aneurysm, which is mainly thrombosed, but there is a patent lumen in the middle of this aneurysm of normal caliber. If you look at the conventional angiogram without knowing there is aneurysm, you may not appreciate that there is aneurysm. In cross-sectional imaging, on top of that is ultrasound, you can see this aneurysm, as in this case, you can see there is at least a patent lumen this side, but there is aneurysm, which is mainly thrombosed around it. Also, we can assess by the B mode the degree of calcification or non-calcification of the plaque. This is partial calcification, and the plaque, this is heavily calcification, but sometimes the plaque is soft. And these soft plaques are important because they can be the source of emboli. So it is important that we know that and try to deal with this problem by whatever intervention, stent graft or whatever. So it is important also to differentiate if the plaque is soft or not. For us in particular, in carotid Doppler, this is very important criteria in our report to say if this is soft or not. Even patients who have soft plaque and no significant stenosis, but the patient is symptomatic, I think you will start to consider this and vascular surgeon should deal with this, even if there is no stenosis, because it can be the source of problem. So all of this done just by looking at ultrasound. Without any other adjunctive. If you add to this color Doppler, it helps us to identify the vessel, to identify the stenosis, and also it's a very important tool to know the direction of flow. And this can be crucial sometimes in our management. This is a nice example in which you can see the artery red and the vein blue. However, this is not a mandatory. You can just change the button in the ultrasound, you can see it the other way around, as in this case. This is the artery blue and the vein is red because of the setting. Note here that the external iliac artery is occluded. The point I just mentioned about the importance of color Doppler, that it tells us the direction of flow, is very clear in this example. In this example, you have occluded common iliac artery. However, the flow is towards the probe, in this case, in the anterior iliac artery, and going away from the probe in the external iliac artery. So really the supply for the external iliac artery is coming from the external iliac artery, which can be a valuable information sometimes. Now, sometimes we look at the artery and we think it's totally occluded. No flow in the color Doppler. You see that's, you know, there's filling defect in it. In that case, you have to apply power Doppler, which is special facility in the ultrasound, because that facility is 3 to 5 times more sensitive in detecting flow in these arteries. So don't hurry to say this is occluded. Apply this, and in this case, believe me, before the color Doppler, before we apply the power Doppler, it looked as if it's totally occluded. Once we apply power Doppler, clearly there is still trickle flow within it, and this again can be important in our assessment how to deal with these arteries accordingly. Now, the third way of assessing arteries using Doppler ultrasound is the waveform of the artery. In the lower limb, the waveform should be triphasic. This is the normal waveform created by the pulsation. And the more we have disease in the artery, we move towards biphasic, which is like mild disease or calcification, to monophasic when there is moderate disease, and then towards what we call tardus parvus, in which you will find very low amplitude, and that indicates to you there is severe disease. The other criteria linked to the spectral waveform is the peak systolic velocity and the ratio between the peak systolic velocity at the site of the stenosis or just proximal to it. If the artery has a peak systolic velocity at a certain point of more than 400, and the ratio between the peak systolic velocity at this site and just proximal to it more than 4, then there is more than 75% stenosis. This is the way we quantify the degree of the stenosis. And this, by the way, an important tool sometimes, which is more, you know, it can give you more information than other cases. Yesterday, for example, there was a CT angiogram, which it looks like as if there is 30, 40 stenosis when you calculate it. But when we did the Doppler ultrasound, there is high peak systolic velocity above 400. So a Doppler ultrasound can help you really to tell you there is a real stenosis here, sometimes even, sometimes more accurate than CT or MRA. So this is another way to assess it, the spectral waveform as well as the peak systolic velocity. We use a curved probe to assess the pelvic iliac arteries, while in the infrainguinal arteries we use linear 5 to 10 megahertz probes. As you know, I mean, Doppler ultrasound is have advantage. Okay. Just quickly, 3 minutes. This is a very sensitive and specific exam. It is the primary post-treatment tool. I mean, I mentioned earlier that the ABI is the primary one for assessment. Now, for patients after that, we assess patients by Doppler ultrasound. Okay. Unfortunately, it's still operator dependent. We are very proud of our technologists who are very skillful, so we have no problem about this. But really, it depends on the skill of our technologists, and it depends on the habitus of the patient and his cooperation. The problem with Doppler ultrasound, if there is multi-level disease, then its sensitivity becomes less, and also in arteries below the knee, especially if they are heavily calcified. This is the challenging bit in the exam. This is just a quick example of normal triphasic Doppler waveform. This is monophasic Doppler waveform in superficial femoral artery caused by proximal stenosis. This is another example in which there is common iliac artery stenosis, and this led to monophasic Doppler waveform in all arteries distal to it, in external iliac, common femoral, and superficial femoral arteries. All arteries after the stenosis became monophasic. As a general guideline, we use ABI, segmental pressure, PVR in assessment of all these patients, and then we use Doppler to assist us. We don't use CT or MRI except in selected patients or for better planning in complex patients, but not routine anymore. So Dr. Shammari was right when he told me this some time ago. It took me some time to believe it. Now, this is this is the way we are now following. Again, in a brief, as I told you, if it is normal result, we have to exercise the patient. If it is normal, that's the end of the story. If not, then we do PVR and segmental pressure, and then targeted ultrasound. If it's abnormal, we do the PVR and segmental pressure and duplex ultrasound. If it is not reliable, we depend in toe brachial index, and accordingly, we complete the cycle. Just 1 minute about CT and MRI, as I mentioned earlier. They are perfect images. They are almost like conventional angiography. Really, you don't need, if you want really good images, don't say I have to have conventional angiogram. We can produce to you excellent imaging by CT angiogram and MRA. With CT, the same problem of radiation and contrast with conventional angiography is there. However, generally, the amount of contrast used is less, though the radiation is more. But the big advantage of the CT angiogram is the time. In seconds, you finish the exam and you cover the whole area. With conventional angiogram, it is invasive, but it also takes around, let us say, 45 minutes between the patient in and out. So this is a big achievement. After we do the CT, we can look at the axial images, but also we can have reconstruction in different very advanced technologies to enhance the images and to deal with the problem of calcified plaques and bone adjacent to the arteries and produce really valuable images. Just half a minute about MRI. We can do it without contrast or with contrast. There are three ways at least to do MRA without contrast: phase contrast, time of flight, and fresh blood imaging. The first two are usually used in intracranial vessels. The advantage of phase contrast that it can tell you the direction of flow, which can be valuable. It's only this, the only way, and the Doppler that can tell you really the direction of flow among all the methods of assessment. In lower limb, if we want to do it, we use fresh blood imaging, MRA. It can produce excellent images, but if you have excellent technologies, excellent protocol, and excellent patient, and one of them usually is missing. So we don't usually use this method. That's why we always, if we need MRA, we use MRI with contrast. The advantage of it, there is no ionizing radiation. The contrast is much safer than the contrast used in CT scan. However, it has the disadvantage sometimes of exaggerating the degree of the stenosis. And if the patient is not cooperative, old and so on, abnormal, this can be a problem, which in CT is an advantage because it's done very quickly. We can overcome this problem. But still, it's a very nice, excellent method for advanced patients. So in conclusion, ABI is the excellent screening test. It's a good standard as primary investigation. It has its own shortcomings, especially with calcification, which can be solved by BVR, which is a second line of assessment. If the patient has normal ABI in rest and in exercise and normal PVR, then this is the end of the story. We don't need for further assessment. You don't need to refer these patients to us. If it is abnormal, then we can proceed to do segmental pressure and to do localized Doppler ultrasound to know where's the disease. We keep the CTA and MRA for more complex cases. And from our experience, according to what I was told in the last year, we have dropped really in using CT angiogram rather than increase. We are more depending now in all the physiologic tests and PVR. Thank you very much.